All right. All right, let's get started. So, real quick, has everyone at least started the skip list project? I know one team hasn't. Won't name names, that's okay. Has everyone at least looked at the documentation, understand what you're going to be doing? Again, I told you guys that writing a skip list is easy, and I don't want you to, I don't want you to say, oh, well, that means I can put it off till the day before it's due. Writing a generic skip list that's not concurrent and doesn't have to do reverse iteration is easy, but doing those extra steps is a little more challenging because you have to get the ordering right. So the sooner you get on it, the better. The other thing, too, is last night I posted a announcement on Piazza of where to get access to the MemSQL machines. Right, you don't SSH directly into Narwhal. There's a web interface. You can reserve one of the machines, and then you can SSH into it through one of the PDL machines. Has anybody tried to do that yet? Okay, so that one, when you get access to the MemSQL machine, you will have root access. You will be able to install all the packages and everything you need. Right, and again, there's instructions that tells you what will get wiped after 24 hours and how to make sure you can save data in your home directory. Then that will be preserved after every wipe, right? And again, if you're not using it, give up the lease so that somebody else can come along and use it, okay? All right, so for today's class, we're now gonna switch and start talking about more OLAP things. So up until this point in the semester, we've been focusing on transaction processing, right? Transaction processing for concurrency control. And then the last two or three lectures have been about these latch-free indexes to do fast transaction lookups. So now we're going to start, at this point in the semester, we're going to start switching gears and start bringing in more of the analytical operations that we're going to want to do in our database system. And we're going to see what components we need inside of our database system to accelerate these types of queries, because they're going to be much different than the transaction processing workloads we've looked at so far. So we're going to start off talking about the different type of OLAP schemas that you can have. And then we'll talk about the projection and the columnar indexes from the SQL Server paper you guys read. And then we'll spend most of our time after that for the sort of the second half of the lecture talking about bitmap indexes, right? Because these are more common things that you'll have, and it's the most common type of index you would have for OLAP queries. So just understand the sort of the overview of what we're looking at from an application standpoint of view. The typical way that people do, want to do analytics on their databases, they sort of have this setup like this, where you sort of have the front end OLTP silos, right? And this is where all the transactions are coming in. You're updating the state of the database. And usually these guys can be, sort of independent from each other, right? You could have, you say you're like Zynga, this OLTP database would be for one game, this would be for another game, and so forth, right? And then what happens is you're going to take the sort of the change log or the updates that occur in this OLTP databases, and you're going to stream them into this extract, transform, and load component, or ETL component, to basically do whatever cleaning you need to do and convert the data from the OLTP silos into sort of common universal schema. And then you're going to stick this in your OLAP database. And this will be a giant data warehouse where you'll have all the data from the front ends, and this is where you're going to run your analytical queries. This is typically how people have been doing this for the last 15 or 20 years. And then for this class, we've been focusing on, we'll start talking about how to do more HTAP things, so hybrid workloads, where instead of having to have this strict partition between the OLTP side and the OLAP side, we can now start doing some of the queries you'd want to do on an OLAP database directly on the front end. But we're not there yet. So today's class, we're just basically going to focus on how do you speed up queries that are running on this side here. So in the paper, they talk about how the columnar indexes that they added for SQL Server were designed to accelerate decision support systems, or DSS applications. And DSS applications are, these are applications that people build that allow an organization to look at their data and analyze it to help them make decisions about future actions they want to take. Right? The idea is that you would look at all the historical data you've collected from your OLTP front ends, right? Because that's where the new information is coming in from these transactions. And you'll do analytics on them to answer questions to help you figure out what to do in the future, right? And this is sort of like, this is sort of what the promise of what big data was really all about, right? When big data first came out, the idea was like, we're gonna store everything and then do analytics on top of it to figure out, you know, what should we do next, or try to find interesting trends. Nowadays, it's sort of transitioned big data to means also sort of this machine learning stuff that people are doing. But for this, for this class here, we're just focusing on the traditional DSS workloads. So the example that I always like to give is actually one from Mike Stonebreaker. The way to think about a DSS system, a classic example would be, say you're Walmart, and you have a database of every single item that anybody's ever bought in the history of Walmart. And there's a hurricane coming up next week, and it's going to hit Florida. So what you want to do is go back into your historical data and say, the last time a hurricane hit Florida, what items were bought the most the week before the hurricane and the week after the hurricane? Because then now you can tell all your suppliers and whatever logistics companies you're working with to make sure that those products are available at your Walmarts in Florida, you know, in preparation of that hurricane, right? This is different than like just saying, oh, well, I think people are probably going to need water, right? Just guessing and figuring out what to ship to the store. You can actually look at the data and know exactly what people bought. So this is a sort of great example of what decision support systems are used for. So we'll see also now the way you model a DSS application, the database schema, because it's going to look a lot different than how you may want to model an OLTP application or OLTP database. And in particular, in the paper you guys read, they talk about trying to support star schemas and Snowflake schemas or star schema queries. Right? So I want to spend a little time understanding what these two differences are. And again, this will motivate why we actually want to build the OLAP indexes that we're going to talk about today. So let's say we have a sort of simple application that's, you know, the Walmart example again, right? And what's going to happen is we're going to have this schema where we have sort of this center table here, and everything is going to emanate out from it. Right? This is sort of why it's called a star schema. Like you have the center of the star, then all those sort of things coming out of it. So this table in the middle is called the fact table. And this is where you have all the events or the facts of things that occurred in your application. So in the case of Walmart, this would be, the fact table would be all the items that people have bought. Right? Every single time someone went and bought something online or went through the cash register and scanned something, you would get a new event in this fact table here. And so what you see is that inside the fact table, we're not actually going to store any extra information, redundant information about the items that were bought. Right? We'll always have the price and quantity because that's unique per, you know, per purchase. But for things like what product it was, what customer bought it, where it was bought, for these we're going to have foreign key references to the outer tables. So in this case here, then we have a product foreign key reference to the product table here. And these outer tables are called dimension tables. Right? This is where the actual data that's stored for a particular product or location, this is where it's located. Right? So anytime, again, you want to do a, say, you know, figure out, you know, find me all the products that were bought in this location that were made by this manufacturer, you would do a join between the product table and the customer table and the dimension table. Or I guess in that case, the location table. Right? This looks a lot different in some ways than how we think about OLTP applications, because the OLTP databases usually look like a tree. Right? A warehouse has a district has a customer has orders have order items. Right? This is sort of modeled differently. So now contrast a star schema with a Snowflake schema. And so this is the same application we had before, but now instead of just having sort of one level of dimension tables outside of the center, we're going to have multiple levels, right? So now the dimension table can also have a foreign key of reference to another one. So in this case here, right, we embedded the category name, category description for a product inside the product dimension table, but now we're going to have a foreign key of reference from the category from the product dimension table to the category dimension table. Right? So this is just, you know, doing this is just normalizing further the star schema, right? So before, you know, this was a lower normal form, but now we're, you know, this is 3NF or BCNF. So why would you want to do one versus the other? What's an obvious thing? Right, so one, in the case of the star schema, we're repeating the category name over and over again, right? This is the normal forms that we talked about in the intro class. The other thing is that now to do joins, so although we're going to have less redundant information because now we're going to have foreign key references, to further dimension tables, it's going to make doing joins more complicated. Because with a star schema, it's only, you know, one level of dimension table. In the Snowflake schema, it could be multiple levels. Right? So the two trade-offs, the two issues we have to deal with, whether we want to use a star schema or a Snowflake schema, is first, when we normalize things out in a Snowflake schema, it's going to take up less storage space because we're not repeating, you know, attributes over and over again. But now, but it relies on us in our application code to be good stewards of the database and make sure that we don't have any integrity or consistency violations. Meaning if we change the name of a manufacturer or a category in our product dimension table, if we're using a star schema, we need to make sure that we update all of those entries. So that way, you know, things don't look inconsistent. And then as I said, the other issue we deal with is query complexity. So as humans, the Snowflake schema looks better. Right? It looks like it's cleaner and nicer. But from a database system implementation standpoint, supporting Snowflake schemas is more complicated because now you have these multiple levels of joins you have to do. And figuring out what the right way to do those orderings, as we know, is very difficult. So typically, it was always the case that a query on a star schema will always be faster than a query on a Snowflake schema. So when you read like the literature about how to like set up a data warehouse or a DSS database, they usually will recommend that you do a star schema, right? For this reason, like you're willing to pay the storage penalty of denormalizing your dimension tables in exchange for getting faster runtimes. So if we think about now this, whether we're using a Starflake schema or a Snowflake schema or a star schema, we want to think about how could we add an index to speed up queries in our application. So it's kind of obvious that for a dimension table, it's okay for us to use a B-tree because these things are going to be much smaller, right? Think of like, again, going back to Walmart, the fact table is going to be every single item that anyone's ever bought. It's probably in the high, you know, high millions or even billions. But the number of products that Walmart could sell is much smaller than that. So the dimension table is going to be much, much smaller than the fact table. So we can put a B plus tree or a skip list or whatever we want on the dimension table, and that's fine. But now to do this on the fact table is actually going to be tricky or very wasteful. Right? Because think about if you had a B plus tree on looking up like someone's zip code or some basic information about the fact table, then you're basically going to have this sort of not a really wide fan out on the B plus tree, but then this huge chain of pointers to the tuples that have the same attribute. So let's look at an easy example. So again, then we have the sales facts table and we have the location table. So the query we want to do is we want to count all the items that were bought at a store in the location location with the zip code 15217. So the way you would execute this query is you know you have an equality predicate on the zip code here. So we could use the B plus tree to jump on the dimension table to find the ID, the location ID for zip code 15217. But now when we want to join this with the fact table, we either have to do a sequential scan across all entries, which again could be in the billions, or we have like a B plus tree that could jump to just all, you know, every single item that was ever bought at this location. But even that's going to be wasteful because again, you're going to have to basically traverse the index, which will be fast, but then you have to do this huge linear scan on the pointers to then jump to the offset that has the data that you need. Then to do the computation. So this is motivating why we want these sort of different indexes than we saw for the OLTP side for our OLAP queries. We want to speed these things up. We want to add indexes for our fact tables to speed up queries that have to access elements from the dimension table. All right, so the paper you guys read was this, this paper that I really like from the Microsoft guys about adding columnar indexes to SQL Server. And it's crazy to think, like for me, I remember this paper coming out when I was grad school and I was like, oh, this is kind of cool, this is pretty exciting. But now I realize it was 7 years ago, which is crazy. And so it was sort of the first implementation they had for adding columnar indexes in SQL Server. There will be a follow-up paper that I'll discuss in a few slides that says how they sort of overcame a lot of the deficiencies that were in the paper that you guys read. And remember, the provenance of SQL Server was that it was originally based on Sybase. Right, they, in the 1990s, they bought the Sybase source code license, or Microsoft bought the Sybase source code license from Sybase, and then they converted the work from Windows NT, and that became SQL Server. And since then, they've diverged heavily, right? Sybase eventually sort of fizzled out and got bought by SAP, and now it's pretty much, as far as I know, in maintenance mode. Meaning they'll maintain things, but they're not really adding all these new features that you would expect in a modern system. Whereas SQL Server is actually considered to be one of the state-of-the-art systems, right? We talked about the hackathon stuff a few weeks ago, right? That's their in-memory LTP engine, and now the stuff they're talking about here is the Apollo engine for doing fast analytics. So SQL Server I actually consider to be one of the most state-of-the-art systems that are available today, because they're still spending a lot of time fixing it up. Whereas Sybase is sort of gone away. All right, so the basic idea what they're going to do here is they're going to take chunks of rows, and for each column in that row, they're going to extract out the values for those for the attribute or that column, and then store that as a contiguous columnar index. So in this first implementation, all the original data that's in the row store tables is still going to be there. Right, they're just going to add these auxiliary data structures to allow you to do fast OLAP queries directly on them. And so the problem is, though, in this first version, you can't actually update the table. Right? So as soon as you say, in this paper here, as soon as you say, for this table, I want to add columnar indexes, SQL Server would freeze the table and make it read-only. The reason why they had to do this is because they had no way of mapping back an offset in the columnar indexes back to the original value. Right, the other way around. So if you updated the row store, you couldn't update any of the columnar indexes because the ordering of the columns would be different of the rows and the columns would be different than how they are in the rows. The thing I like about this paper, though, although it has again a lot of limitations because it's sort of the first implementation of this idea, is that they made a lot of use of the existing components that were available in SQL Server. Right, so rather than building a brand new database management system just to add these sort of support for columnar operations or OLAP indexes, they used some of the existing parts that they had in SQL Server to integrate these new indexes. And what I like about this is because in the same way that I said with Hackathon, you didn't want to build a brand new database management system just to do fast transactions and then lose compatibility with all the tools that were available for SQL Server, with these new columnar indexes in SQL Server, you can just plot them down and reuse all the same stuff or all the same products that are available for SQL Server today, like Crystal Reports, Tableau, MicroStrategy, all the things you would do in your application at the application level. Still just work, because at the end of the day, it just looks like SQL Server. Internally, they have these extra indexes to speed up the OLAP queries. So it sort of looks like this. All right, say we have a data table, and we have four attributes or four columns. So the first thing they're going to do is they're going to split up the table horizontally into row groups. And each row group is, I think, a million tuples. And then they're going to generate an index that for all the values that correspond to a single column or attribute. Right? And this is what they're going to store contiguously. And then they're going to pass this into a component or do some encoding and compression. We'll talk about what that's doing in a second. And then they'll store this in the internal blob storage mechanism for the database system. And again, this is an example where they're reusing the parts or the components of the system to add in their columnar indexes. So the blob storage, again, is when you have a var binary or a large varchar, you would store this in this data here. So they're basically taking the columnar indexes that they generate, packing the byte stream up into a blob, and then storing this in the separate storage here. And there's a little segment directory or lookup table to say, if I'm looking for row group 3 at column C, where do I go find the column index I'm looking for? All right, it's pretty straightforward. So to figure out what's going on or what's available, what columnar indexes are available, they had to add two additional informations to the internal catalog of the system. So the first is that you're going to have the segment directory that's going to allow you to do a lookup for a row group and a column offset to get to the blob that has the columnar index. But they're also going to maintain some metadata about each columnar index in a row group. So they'll say what size it is, how many rows that it has, the min and max values. Right? So this is useful to say if I'm looking for a value that I know is not in between this range here for this column segment, then I can just not even bother decompressing it and looking at it. Right? These are called zone maps, usually in databases. We'll see them again on Thursday. But then you also keep track of how the column segment for the index was encoded, right? We'll talk about the different encoding schemes in a second. And then there's also going to be the data dictionary that's going to allow us to do dictionary encoding to map the dictionary IDs to the original values, right? And this is sort of a way to get do compressed columnar indexes. So I want to talk a little bit about dictionary encoding now. We'll talk more about dictionary compression or dictionary encoding when we do a lecture on database compression. But I'll say at first that this is probably the most common compression scheme you can have or people use in databases. As far as I know, I mean, anybody that supports compression is going to be doing something like this. Ahana does this, Hyper does this, MemSQL does this, Redshift does this, right? So this technique is going to show up a bunch of different times throughout the semester. But for now, I'll just sort of gloss over it at a high level so you understand what's going on. So the way dictionary encoding works is that you're going to have a separate auxiliary table internally inside of a database system, your database, that's going to map unique values for a given column or attribute to some kind of unique dictionary ID, right? And the way, when we look at the table in a second, the way you actually sort the entries of the table can vary based on what you're trying to achieve. So one way maybe to sort the entries by the frequency, how often the value occurs, or you could sort them in lexicographical ordering. But for, I think in this paper, they use the first one. And then now, for each tuple in the columnar index, instead of storing the original value, like the varchar field or whatever it is that we're dictionary compression, we're going to store a 32-bit ID that we can then do a lookup in this dictionary table to find what the original value was. So it's going to allow us to store sort of fixed the length values within a columnar index and storing them much smaller, storing IDs that are much smaller than the original values. So let's look at an example here. All right, so we have two columns. We have the ID column and the city column. So we want to do dictionary compression or dictionary encoding on the city column here, because you can see we have a bunch of varchar fields that we're repeating over and over again. So we're repeating the key New York, Chicago, and Pittsburgh multiple times. So our dictionary encoding, dictionary compressed column would look like this. So we have our dictionary table, and we have a mapping from some dictionary ID to a pair that says what the original value was, and then some counter to say how often that this thing occurred, right? So 0 would map to New York, 1 would map to Chicago, and 2 would map to Pittsburgh. So now inside of the actual column, right, we don't store the varchar field, we just store the integer values. So now if I wanted to say, find me all of the entries where city equals New York, I know I just need to do rip through this column and do a comparison where, you know, is the value equal to 0? And that's much, much faster than having to do, you know, two string comparisons, right? Yes?
Yeah, so this is the case only in case of denormalized tables, right, when you have repeated values.
Her question is this the case you would do this on denormalized tables? Yes, you can do this for anything actually, right? Sometimes in the fact table you do want to have there could be a varchar field. You could do this. You could do this on the dimension table too. When we talk about database compression, you will see that there's some databases like IBM Blue and HANA. They use dictionary compression for everything, right? So it doesn't necessarily have to do this for the fact table or dimension table. I'm just showing this as a general purpose example. But this is what they're going to do when they create the columnar indexes. Yes?
So if you want to do a query on special city, does that mean you still need to scan the whole column sequentially?
So his question is, if I want to do a lookup on, say, Chicago, do I still need to scan the entire column? Yes.
But would that be slow?
The statement is, would that be slow? Well, one, we'll talk about, I mean, you could, there are techniques to sort the columns so that they go in the order that the IDs go, so that you can do binary search to jump to the things that you're looking for. Again, I don't want to get too bogged down on compression, but basically, say I want to say, find me all the entries where the city equals Chicago. So there's actually a reverse map that I'm not showing here that you can take the string Chicago and get back the dictionary ID. Right? It doesn't always be one direction. So then now I have the ID, and I can do actually a vectorized search, a SIMD search across this, where I can take chunks or multiple entries at a time and do a single instruction to do the comparison. So that's going to be way faster. Like, yes, you should have to do a sequential scan, but like, it's going to be way, there's techniques to make that go much faster than just doing string comparison. Okay? Again, I don't want to get too much into the dictionary compression stuff, but just They talk about it in the paper, so I want to bring it up here. Okay. The other two type encoding schemes they talk about are to do value encoding, and the idea here is you want to transform a value domain for an attribute into a bunch of smaller values that are distinct. Right? Some way to think about this is like, say I have a bunch of integers that are 64-bit integers that are, you know, 1 billion, 1 billion and 1, 1 billion and 2. Instead of storing 1 billion over and over again, I can map them down to a smaller domain and keep track of like, oh, well, the original value was whatever the current value I'm storing plus 1 billion. So now I can store the values in a much smaller data type, like a 16-bit or 32-bit integer, and always map it back to the original value. There's other techniques to do what's called delta encoding, where instead of storing, 1002, 1003 over and over again, I can just store the base value of my columnar index in my column segment to be 1000, and then the subsequent values after that would just be the delta from that base value. So I could map 1001, 1002, 1003 to 1000 plus 1 plus 1 plus 1. Right? I'll talk a little bit more about doing delta coding and other techniques in next class, but the main idea what they're trying to do here is like rather than storing the whole value in all its bits over and over again, we can then maybe try to map it down to a smaller data type and get better compression or get better cache locality or better cache usage, because to fetch some number of tuples from a column segment index, we have to go grab less from DRAM. All right, and then the last one is run-length encoding. This is a pretty common technique that occurs, I think, outside of databases as well, but it's super, super useful in the context of databases. And so the idea here is that within a column index, we want to compress runs of the same value within a single column into these triplets that say there is a repeated value and here's how often it's repeated. So this triplet is going to say what's the original value of the attribute, and then we'll have the start position of where we are in our column segment, and then how many numbers we're going to have in this repeated run. And then to make this work, though, as we'll see in the next slide, in order to get the best bang for the buck for RLE, you actually want to sort the columns in such a way that you maximize the compression opportunities. So they talk about this VertiPack tool in the system. It's basically trying to solve an NP-complete problem to figure out what's the optimal sort order of the columns across all columns that maximizes the performance of the entire workload. So let's look at an example here. Say we have, again, two columns. We have the ID, and then we have the sex column. And for simplicity, we'll just say we have male and female. Right? We only have two options. All right, so we want to do run-length encoding on this thing here. So what you would end up with is a series of triplets like this, where you would have, on the first one, you say the first value is male. It starts at offset 0, and then I have a length of 3. So that would correspond to male, male, male here. Right? And then you do the same going down for the rest. So the problem with RLE, in some cases, is that if you have a lot of entries where the length of the run is 1, then you end up wasting space, right? So in this case here, I have three triplets in a row, female, male, female, where the length of the run is 1. So for this example here, I have 10 entries, and I can store male, female in a single byte per entry. So this would be 10 bytes. But in this case here, I have 5 entries with 3 bytes apiece, so that's 15 bytes. So the compressed version using RLE is actually larger than the original value, or the original data. So that's bad. So this is what I was saying, that if you actually end up pre-sorting the column so that all the males appear first, followed by all the females, then the RLE compressed scheme looks like this. Now you only need 2 entries, 3 bytes apiece. So now you only need 6 bytes to store what was originally 10 bytes. Now the reason why you have to store the offset is the way this typically works is you could store this in a bunch of blocks, and you want to know you want to be able to know how to jump into some location without having to decompress everything that came before, right? So you could jump, do a binary search in these list of these triplets and say, well, I know where I'm at in my column segment because I know where my starting point is, so I don't have to start always from the beginning. So again, this is sort of an example why if you pre-sort things ahead of time, you may get better compression using RLE. What's really crazy to think about RLE for this particular example here, right? I'm only showing 10 entries, but if I had a billion entries for a billion people, I could store the sex of a billion people in only 6 bytes, right? That's pretty crazy what you can get for this. So is this sort of clip what RLE is doing? So this is another example, another type of columnar index that the SQL Server guys could support. But we'll see RLE show up later on when we talk about doing bitmap compression. All right, so far we've been only talking about the lower storage level of the system, right? We build these columnar indexes, we're storing them in the blob storage, we know how to find them, right? Doing the lookup in the segment directory. But they're useless to the system unless the other parts, the higher level part of the stack or the architecture, knows that they actually exist. So in the paper, they talk about what they need to modify in the query processing components of the database system in order to recognize that you have these columnar indexes and make use of them. So there's really sort of two parts that they talk about. The first is that you have to modify the query planner and the optimizer to now be aware that these sort of special indexes exist, how big they are, and can use them in the decision-making components of the optimizer, right, and compute the cost of actually executing the query accessing them. The other major change that they did was they added new operators in the execution engine of the system to now be able to process column segments at a vector at a time, right? Instead of using sort of the volcano or iterator style model that we talked about at the beginning of the semester, instead of looking at a tuple at a time, you can actually access a batch of tuples or a vector of tuples. And this allows you to do some additional optimizations that they don't really get into, but we'll talk about when we talk about vectorized execution later in the semester. But basically, allows you to reduce the number of function calls you have. You're calling get next on your child. You can get a whole chunk of data, process it, and then move on to the next one. They also talk about how they can use the columnar indexes to help them build bitmaps on the fly to help them do joins more efficiently. So instead of building everything sort of by examining every single tuple, you can look at these bitmap or these columnar indexes and build the additional bitmaps you need to do joint evaluation. All right, so again, the paper you guys read was from 2010. This was the first version of these columnar indexes in SQL Server, I think it was called Denali. In the later version in SQL Server 2012, it came out in 2012, but it was introduced in SQL Server 2014 and 2016, is these new, is the updates to sort of right all the wrongs or fix all the missing components that were in the paper that you guys read. All right, so the first thing they added was they had support for clustered columnar indexes. So now no longer did you have to always maintain the row store as well as the copies in the column indexes. You can have now the column indexes be the clustering index for the data store. So now you know how to map back and forth between the original data and the columnar indexes. They added support for more data types. So the initial version could only do the basic integers, floats, bar charts, and things like that. But now for all the different data types that SQL Server supports, they can do this now in the newer version. But the key thing they added was, again, because you have the clustered columnar indexes, now you can support insert, updates, and deletes. And the way they're going to do this is that instead of modifying the columnar indexes directly every single time a transaction updates things, you'll apply all the changes to this thing called the delta store. Right? Think of this sort of like, if you're familiar with like how log structured merge trees work or LevelDB, RocksDB, it's like the mem table. Right? You append all the entries to this delta store, and then there'll be a background thread that eventually will then migrate the data from the delta store onto the columnar indexes. Right? We'll see this again on Thursday when we talk about how to support hybrid architectures, hybrid data models inside of our system. This is probably the most common technique to use. Right? And the reason why we do this is because doing an update in a columnar index or columnar table for a transaction is actually really, really slow. Because when you insert, say, a new tuple, it's not like in a row store, you can just copy the bytes directly to its new slot or new location. You actually have to break it up into the different columns and do multiple writes to the different indexes. Right? So that's why you want to use a delta store, because you can append new rows there. And then in the background, you'll eventually migrate them out to the column parts. The thing to make this work, though, is that you have to have the database system be aware that now some of your updates will be stored in the delta store, some of them will be stored in the column side of things. And so you have to be able to seamlessly combine the results for queries from these two different segments so that it appears as a single uniform database. And again, we'll talk more about this on Thursday. This is very, very common. And then instead of doing in-place deletes, you'll mark a bitmap to say at this offset, this particular tuple has been deleted. And then you have to read it anytime you do a lookup to see whether something actually is visible to you or not. Okay? So it's clear what's going on with these columnar indexes. These are designed to make OLAP queries run faster, and they're much different than the B plus trees that we've been looking at so far, because we don't really care about finding exact tuples. We want to be able to find a large segment of tuples that may have particular attributes or satisfy a particular predicate we're trying to evaluate in our query. Okay? All right, so now we can transition and start talking about bitmap indexes. And as I said in the beginning, these are probably the most common OLAP index that a database system will support. As we see it go along, though, it's not as straightforward as just saying I have a bitmap for every value. We'll see how to do more complicated things in a second. So bitmap indexes are pretty old. I think they're around since the 1970s. And there's a paper from 1987 that sort of lays out, you know, what they had done in the past prior to this. So the basic idea of a bitmap index is that we're going to store a separate bitmap, all right, for every unique value on a particular column or attribute in a table. And what will happen is the offset or location of a particular bit in the bitmap tells you whether the tuple of that offset has that particular value or not. So you would say the ith position in the bitmap corresponds to the ith tuple in the table. And then what you'll do is instead of actually storing, you know, one giant bitmap, you know, contiguously in memory, typically what you do is you break them up into smaller chunks, right? It could be 10 megs, 5 megs, 1 meg, doesn't matter. And that makes it easier to allocate pieces incrementally. So let's look at a really simple example. Let's go back to the table we had before, where we have the single column with male and female. So the way you would do this, to do a bitmap index for this field here, you would have a separate bitmap for all the males and separate bitmaps for all the females. So now again, the one tells you, if there's a one in a position or location in the bitmap that tells you whether the tuple at that position has that particular value. So in this case here, for tuple at offset 4, the value in the male bitmap is 0, but the value in the female bitmap is 1, so we know that corresponds to female here. Right? It's pretty straightforward to understand. So now when you want to say, like, find me all the females or all the males, you only have to rip through this single bitmap. You don't have to look at the other ones. So let's look at a more complicated example here. Right? So let's say we want to build a bitmap index on the zip code table, a zip code attribute for the customer dimension. So as a quick guess, do you want to take a guess how many zip codes there are in the US? More than 100, less than 100,000.
Less.
So, throw out a number. Take a guess.
100,000.
He says 1,000. I heard 100,000. All right. It's 43,000. All right. So let's say now we have in our customer dimension table, we have a million tuples. Right? We have a million customers. So if we're going to generate a bitmap index for this thing here, it'd be 10 million times 43,000, right? Which would be 53 gigabytes. So that's pretty wasteful, right? Like, because most of the bitmaps are going to be sparse, be all zeros, right? Now compare this, if we actually just stored the attribute directly without doing a bitmap encoding or bitmap vector or bitmap index, it'd be 10 million times 32 bits because we could store this as a 32-bit integer, and that's, you know, 4 megs. Right, so using a bitmap vector isn't always the best thing to do because you went from, you know, 53 gigs when the original data was just 4 megs. So the other issue we're going to have with the bitmap index is that every single time we insert a new entry into the customer dimension table, we're now going to have to extend or reallocate all the bitmap vectors to now accommodate space for the new tuples we're adding to this thing. And in that case, I mean, that's going to be really slow because now you're going to do mallocing across all these 43,000 bitmap vectors. Now, you can try to amortize the cost by allocating a bunch of extra data ahead of time, right, so that you're not doing this over and over again every single time you start a new customer. But in general, this is a bad idea. So We're going to look at now is a bunch of different ways to sort of have the same essence of a bitmap encode, bitmap index, but look how to do different encoding schemes and different compression schemes to get sort of more or less the same benefit you would get from a bitmap index, but without paying that huge storage cost overhead. So we'll start off with different encoding schemes. So the example that I've showed so far, with, in the case of the zip code or the male-female one, this is called inequality encoding, because we're going to have a bitmap, again, for every unique value for our column, and there will be a 1 or a 0 that tells you whether the tuple of that offset is equivalent to the value that's represented by a particular bitmap. But there's three other approaches you could also use. Another one is to do range encoding or interval encoding. And the idea here is that instead of having one, again, for one unique value, you have one bitmap. You can say, here's an interval of values, or range of values, that are all be represented by a single bitmap. So say I want to have all the zip codes from 15210 to 15219. I can have those combined together and be a single bitmap that would represent all those zip codes. The downside of this, I guess you save space, but the downside is, like, if I want to do an exact lookup that says, find me all the customers for 15217, I'm going to have a lot of false positives when I use a range encoded index, because it's going to represent other zip codes. So I'd still have to go back and look at the original tuple, the original data, and apply another predicate to see whether whether the tuple actually really does match or not. Typically what happens is, as far as I know, I mean, the commercial databases support stuff like this. I think you as the DBA have to specify what these intervals are. I don't know if the database system will figure this out for you. The other two more interesting approaches are to do hierarchical encoding, where we're going to use a tree to identify the empty key ranges to store less space, and we'll see how to do the byte slice encoding, which I think is one of the more interesting approaches here. So the way hierarchical encoding works is that the tree structure will tell you whether there is a one in a slot at a node below its current location, right? So in this case here, I would have at the root the bitmap would be 1010. So this would say at the first position node, there's definitely a one. At the second one, there's a zero. At the third one, there's a one. And at the fourth one, those are a zero, right? So this is not actually encoding any of the values. Only in the leaf nodes are the values actually going to be represented. Right? It's just telling you whether there's anything actually here below. So in this case here, at this node here, we'd have one to say that there is at least one in the bitmap here, zero because there's nothing here, one because there's at least one, and one at least here, right? And then this one's all zeros because we know there's nothing down here. So the way to understand this is that it's the same bitmap vector that we had before, right? It's going to tell us whether, we're going to read this across going along the leaves. So now I'm showing you the all the zero ones here, but you don't actually store them, right? You only need to store the ones where there actually is a one. So now, before, what was originally is having to store 8 bytes to store everything, I can now just store this in 4 bytes. And I can do a quick lookup along this tree structure to find the thing that I'm actually looking for, right? So as far as I know, no system actually does this, at least that I'm aware of. I think this has issues with cache affinity problems and branching that makes this not as fast as some of the other approaches we'll talk about. The other one that I really like is the byte sliced encoding. So in the same way that, you know, when you think about going from a row store to a column store, you sort of have to, in your mind, you have to understand how you're sort of transforming the table and now thinking of it in a different direction. With byte sliced encoding bitmaps, you sort of have to think of it in the same way too, right? We're sort of turn the model to represent data in a different way. All right, so for the data we're going to look at is a list of zip codes again, and then these are actually all the zip codes of the locations that I lived at in my life, right? Pittsburgh, Compton, Madison, a bunch of different places, right? So we're going to take this first guy here, the first 21042 in Maryland. And if you run this in the binary function, the bin function of Python, you would end up with the bit sequence like this. And so what we're going to do is now we're going to store different bit slices for each of the different tuples at a position in the bit sequence. So the first bit corresponds to whether the value is null or not. And in this case here, it's not null, so it's 0. And then if we take a cursor and start at this uppermost bit here, as we slide across, we're going to add all in the bits that correspond to each position to all these positions here. So at position 16, which is here, it's a 0. Position 15, it's 0. Position 14, it's 1. Right? So now we can do the same thing for all the other attributes. Right? And the way this is going to be stored is, again, not going across horizontally, but actually going vertically. So for position 16, this bitmap, this vector here, is actually going to be stored contiguously in memory. So now what this is going to allow us to do is we can take queries like this, right? Select star from the customer dimension table where zip code is less than 15217. And so now we can walk across each slice and figure out whether we have matching tuples. So we're going to maintain a bitmap that says whether the tuple at this position in the bit slice is still evaluating to true. And if we get to the point where all the positions are 0, we know that there's no matching tuples. If we get to a point where we know that some part of the bit slice evaluated false, we don't have to check it later on, right? So in this case here, since I already have 15217, I know that the upper three bits are 0. So that means that I can skip any entry in the first three bits as I go down that at least has a 1 in them. Right, so this one has a 1 here, and this one has a 1 here and here and there. So I know that as I go across, I don't need to evaluate any of these bits later on, right? Because I've already know that the tuple is going to evaluate the false. Right, so you're doing this sort of essentially, it's the same sort of numerical comparison you would do looking at two integers, but you're sort of breaking it up on a bit by bit basis. And again, when we talk about SIMD and vectorization later on, you're not just looking at, you know, is 0 less than 0, is 0 less than 0, on and on. You actually can combine a bunch of these entries into a single SIMD register and invoke one instruction to allow you to evaluate the predicate across multiple tuples simultaneously. Right? So because we store these things in bit slices, it's going to be much, much faster than having to go have a for look at each one by one. There's other tricks you can do, too, also, to now compute aggregations. Aggregate functions without, again, having to look at every single tuple one by one. So one thing you can do in the case of a sum, all you need to do is count the number of ones in each bit position and multiply it by or this factor here to increase to its original base value. And you just go down the slice and do this over and over again. And then that's a faster way to compute the sum rather than just taking two numbers and incrementing them over and over again. Right? Because again, we can combine multiple bits into a single SIMD vector and invoke one instruction to make that happen. Right, and there's also other instructions that CPU provides, you like Hamming codes and things like that, so you can count the number of ones in a bit slice with a single instruction as well. Right, so there's a bunch of architecture optimizations that make bit slicing really fast. And we'll see, again, a paper later in the semester that talks about how crazy tricks you can do to make all this stuff go really fast. So the bit slicing is sort of clear. Now, there's another way to represent a bitmap index by not storing all the entries for a single value, but actually storing the individual bits for values in these byte-sized vectors. All right, so now we can talk about different compression schemes. So the first approach to do is just use an off-the-shelf general-purpose compression algorithm. Pick your favorite one, LZ4, Snappy. I guess the hot one is now ZSTD. Right, and the idea is that if you're already breaking up your bitmap indexes or columnar indexes, it doesn't matter what it is, into these chunks, you just take that chunk, run Snappy, and compress it. Now the problem with this, though, anytime you actually need to do a read into that bitmap, you have to decompress it first. So if it's a disk-based database system, then this is probably a good trade-off because writing out the disk is super expensive. But an in-memory database, this is a bad trade-off because you're wasting CPU cycles you're spending more time doing the computation than it would be just to hit a cache miss and bring it from DRAM into your CPU caches. So typically, this is not what you want to do. So now I want to talk about two other approaches that I think that are more clever. So the first is going to be the byte-aligned bitmap codes, the BBC encoding. This is actually the technique that Oracle used to use in the 90s and early 2000s. They don't use it anymore, but I think it's kind of cool to look at. And then we'll finish off talking about the roaring bitmaps. So the BBC encoding from Oracle, this was the technique that they came out with in the 1990s to compress bitmaps. Since then, and they have a newer technique, and which is also kind of crazy because Oracle bought Sun. They also control the Spark architecture. And so in the newer Spark chips, like the M7, they actually embed the Oracle compression algorithms for bitmaps and other things directly in the hardware. Right? So that's way faster than just doing everything in software. So the way we're going to get good compression with bitmaps, and the reason why I want to discuss this technique is because it's an example of exploiting something that we know about databases and how they're using bitmaps to get better compression than you would otherwise get from a general purpose algorithm. Right? We exploit the fact that we know in our bitmap indexes that most of the values are going to be zero. Right? And so because of that, we can have a compression scheme that can try to take advantage of that sparse representation. So what we're going to do is we're going to divide our bitmap into chunks based on different categories of byte sequences that they have in there, or better categories of bytes. So we're going to designate a byte to be either a gap byte, and this occurs when all the bits are zero, or we'll have a tail byte when at least one of the bits in the byte is one. And what's going to happen is we're going to encode the chunks where we have a sequence of one or more gap bytes, again, where they're all zero, followed by one or more tail bytes, where at least one of the bits is one. And then we're going to compress the gap bytes with RLE, and then the tail bytes, we'll see, we have to store them in uncompressed format, unless it's a special case where we know only one of the bits is set to one. So let's see an example here. All right, so again, we have some bitmap. We don't care what actually it's storing. All we know is that we have only three bytes in this bitmap have a one in them. So this guy has a one right there, this guy has a one here, and this guy has two ones there. So what we're going to do is we're going to break this up into chunks. Again, remember, so the chunk is specified by having a bunch of gap bytes followed by one or more tail bytes. So our first chunk here, we have two gap bytes where they're all zero, followed by the one where they have a one in them. So that's the tail byte. So the way we can, and this is the second chunk here. So the way we can encode the first chunk is that we have to always store one header byte to tell us what is going to be stored in this chunk. So in the first three bits, we can keep track of the number of gap bytes we have, right? As long as it's less than seven, right? Because you can't store any number greater than seven in three bits. Then we're going to have a bit to say whether it's the tail byte is special, meaning it only has one in it. And then if it's zero, if the special byte is zero, then we know that we have to store the tail bytes verbatim, exact copies afterwards. Or if it's one, then we just store in the last four bits where the position of that one is. Right. So here, the first three bytes, we have 0, 1, 0. This is telling us that we have two gap bytes, one and two. Then the next bit, we have a flag to say whether it's special. And it's one because we know in the tail byte, there's only one. Then in the last four bits, it tells us that the position of this special one bit is at position four there. Right, so in this case here, we took what was now three bytes for this bitmap and stored it in a single byte. Let's go to the next chunk. So here's the more complicated. So here, we know we have 13 gap bytes followed by two tail bytes. So since the number of gap bytes is greater than seven, we can't pack it in just the first three bits like we did before. So for this, we're going to have to store a special flag with 111 that says that the size of the number of gap bytes is greater than seven. So you have to jump to the first byte after the header that says here's where to go find the actual number of gap bytes I have. Right. So in this case here, we're encoding 13. Then you have the special bit here, right? And this says again that there's only one gap byte and there's only one in it. But we have tail byte and there's only one in it. So in this case here, we have two tail bytes, so we have to set this to zero. So then in the next four bits, it'll say how many verbatim bytes we're going to have afterwards. So in this case here, this is encoding two. So then we have the verbatim tail bytes here. So we're taking the exact copies of these two bytes and storing it down here. So what used to be 18 bytes, right? We have six rows down, three rows across. You have 18 bytes. We can now store it in this compressed format for Oracle in five bytes. Right? That's quite significant. Now the downside though is that anytime we need to do a lookup in our bitmap index, we have to decompress from beginning to end. And the other downside is that also is that it's actually really slow on modern hardware. So as I said, Oracle's current system doesn't actually do this. I like it because it shows sort of clever way to encode these bitmaps using low level bits. And you get good compression, but because you have to check all those bits to figure out what is actually being stored, and then based on their contents, that tells you where you want to branch. On a modern superscalar architecture with long pipelines, if the branch predictor guesses wrong, you flush your pipeline and have to fetch everything back in, right? And that's really, really slow. There are better implementations of this idea that are now available. The word-aligned hybrid encoding is one scheme, but nobody actually uses this because it's patented, right? There are other techniques out there, but nobody actually does these things because Oracle owns the patent. All right, there's newer techniques that overcome the encoding problem we have here. Yes?
Could you go over in general where and when compression is useful in memory database systems?
So his question is, can I go over in general when memory compression would be useful? Memory's not free. Memory's not cheap. And memory takes a lot of energy. So if you can store as more data you can, as much data as possible with the least amount of DRAM, that's usually a huge win. When we talk about compression later on, and I think it's next week, you'll see also there's techniques where you don't have to decompress the data to execute some operations, some queries on it based on how it's encoded. In this case here, again, I'm saying the downside is like in order to do any lookup with the BBC, you have to decompress the bitmap. In dictionary encoding, you actually can wait to the very end to actually do the decoding. So you can actually do operations directly on compressed data, and that speeds things up. You typically don't do compression on the OLTP side of the database because you're paying this penalty to decompress it all the time. You typically only do this for the OLAP stuff. And again, we'll see this on Thursday. When you have the delta stored, that's usually stored uncompressed. So if you have transactions update the database, they're inserting new records, you store it in uncompressed format. Then the background thread comes along and migrates it from the delta store to the regular database. That's when you actually you do your compression.
So, but does the OLTP side of the database include all the data records?
His question is, does the OLTP side of the database include all the records? In the modern HTAP systems, right, when you have a single database instance that allows you to do both the transactions and the analytics all in the same box, yes, you'll have complete history. In the bifurcated environment that I showed before, typically what happens is over time you migrate data off of the OLTP side and delete it, but it's still stored in the data warehouse. You see this all the time on like websites you use, like on eBay, for example. eBay deletes auctions after 90 days, right? That's because they move things off of the front end and now it's actually stored in the back end, right? Sometimes you see in like some applications, like if you're sort of recording events that occurred, you don't want to keep the last year of events because that'd be a lot of space. You maybe have some like TTL process where you slowly delete things, expire things over time. So the front end database has the minimum amount of data you need to support the application, but you still archive everything else. But in the HTAP world, what we're trying to talk about here is like you don't actually need to delete everything; you can store everything. But you never, in the case of the analytical queries, you never need to go back and say, find me exactly Matt's record. You want to look at Matt's information in aggregate with everyone else. So in that case, you can store it in a compressed manner. In the back, yes?
Sir, I might have lost track of what is the benefit of doing a bitmap index.
What's the benefit of doing a bitmap index?
Yeah, and when do you want to do it?
So I had the one example. Yeah, so this one example here, right? So, yeah, it's going to allow you to do filtering. So I want to look up, find me all the sales records that were bought in the store location in zip code 15217. So I could have a B+ tree to do a quick lookup in the location dimension table, because that's going to be small. And I'll find the ID of location ID. Then now if I have a bitmap index, depending on how it's encoded, I can do a lookup real quickly in the fact table to find all just those entries. And that's going to allow me to avoid having to do a sequential scan across the entire thing. Right? And again, think about, maybe I should have motivated this more, but we're distinguishing between OLTP and OLAP. In OLTP, you're doing a lookup to find just the, single records, right? Or looking up foreign, foreign keys to find the records that correspond to another single record. You know, for a single customer, find me all their orders. I don't do that in the OLAP queries. So OLAP queries, I want to look at all the orders that were bought at this location, at this time range, right? In those kind of attributes. So I'm not looking at a single record, I'm looking at an aggregate record. And so bitmap indexes can allow me to do that more quickly.
So like filtering is all that you want to do.
His statement is filtering is all that you want to do with a bitmap index. I mean, that's the point of index, right? That's what an index does, right? It's avoiding a sequential scan. Okay? Yes?
So is it true that the column index is only useful when the cardinality is low?
His question is, would you only want to use a columnar index when the cardinality is low? So in the case of like the dictionary encoding, it doesn't matter because you're always going to be, instead of storing bar charts, you can store individual, 32-bit integers, right? For the bitmap indexes, yes, if the cardinality is super high, then the size of your indexes is going to be way larger than the original data, right? And what I'm showing you here are some techniques to maybe reduce the overhead of bitmap indexes. But like, yes, if I have a billion unique values for this column, I wouldn't want to make a bitmap index for that because it's going to be useless, right? So yes, the cardinality is low is when these things are, again, think about going back to these dimension tables, right? For the state, it's easier to look at the star schema one, right? Say if I want to do like on location, I mean, how many locations could I possibly have for like a store? Maybe the hundreds, maybe the thousands, right? So if I want to do fast lookups for this, my bitmap index is not going to be really wide, right? Because I'm not going to have a lot of different unique values for the location. Right, and it allows me to jump exactly to get the data that I need, rather than having to do a sequential scan. We'll see. I don't want to jump ahead too much in the semester. We'll see some papers that argue actually you don't want any indexes at all. If you just have a fast vectorized query engine that uses query compilation, doing sequential scans is super, super fast as it is, and indexes don't really actually help. The cost of maintaining those indexes is overshadowed by the performance you can get with a super fast engine. We'll get there. We're not there yet.
Yeah, I'm a bit confused. So if I use tree to as index, the time complexity is O log N, right?
Yes.
If you scan it sequentially, the time complexity is always O N, even if you vector.
So his statement is he's confused because if you do a lookup on an index, it's log N.
Yeah.
But it's log N to get to the key value pair, right? To get to the bottom. What would be at the bottom of a B plus tree index on the location? No, it'd be giant linked list. Then you're still scanning now, and then that linked list is going to contain pointers to the actual original tuple,
yeah.
Right? So if I have a bitmap index, I can just jump to that. Yes, it's linear search, but it's still gonna be much faster. Right, because the bitmap indexes you can rip through much more quickly because you can do things in a vectorized manner with SIMD.
But for the bitmap, you have to maintain the same order for the row-wise record.
His statement is for the bitmap index, you have to maintain the same order for the row-wise table. Yes, if you're not storing things if the base table is in a row-oriented format. We'll talk about more about the column stores, row stores next class. Okay? All right. So to finish up real quickly. So again, in the Oracle BBC format, you don't support random access. Any single time you want to check to see whether a value is actually present, you have to go decompress and start from the beginning. So I want to talk about a more modern variant of storing a compressed index bitmap. This thing called roaring bitmaps. So this is actually a newer data structure that came out, I think, 2 years ago by this guy, Daniel Lemur, in Canada. He's a professor up there. I highly encourage you to go read his blog. He's sort of like one of those hacker professors that like does awesome stuff. And like instead of writing papers, he writes blog entries that talk about what they do. So we'll see his hash function later on when we talk about hash joins. But the roaring bitmaps is sort of something that he talks about on his blog. And then there's a paper that came out 2 years ago that describes it. So the basic idea is that we're going to store 32-bit integers in this sort of multi-level or two-level indexing structure, where sometimes we're going to store things as these dense chunked bitmaps, and sometimes we're going to store them as just regular, you know, packed arrays. But we're going to do the same sort of kind of value encoding you saw in the columnar index paper from Microsoft to convert really large values or data types into smaller 16-bit representations. And this roaring bitmaps is open source, it's Apache licensed, and is actually used now, it's written in a bunch of different languages, and it's used in Lucene and Spark and Hive and a whole bunch of other sort of Hadoop ecosystem systems. So this is basically how it looks. So we say, we're a real simple example here, where we're just gonna have four chunks, right, or four partitions. And each of these guys are gonna point to a container. In some cases, the container will be our bitmap index, or our bitmap. In other cases, it's going to be just a regular array. So what we're going to do is for each value, each key or value, we're going to do an insert into our bitmap index. The first thing we're going to do is going to figure out what chunk it goes to by dividing it by 2 to the 16. And then now, since we know what the base number is for this, for the key we're storing, we only have to store the key value modded by 2 to the 16. And that's enough for us to figure out how to get back to the original value. It's sort of the same, similar to the encoding scheme you saw for Microsoft. And then what happened is if the number of values in our container is less than 4096, then we'll just keep that as an array. Otherwise, we'll store things as a bitmap. And the idea here is that when it's less than 4096, it's actually much smaller and faster to store things as an array. And only when we go above that, then you want to store things as the bitmap. So let's look at an example. Say we want to store the key 1,000. So the first thing you would do is divide it by 2 to the 16. In this case, it would be 0. So that would tell you want to store it at this chunk here and store it in this container. And then what we're going to store inside of the array is just the value mod 2 to the 16. In this case, it's just 1,000. Right? And we want to get this key out, we just do the reverse of this. So now, say we want to store a larger key, in this case here, 199,000. Same thing, we divide by 2 to the 16, that would tell us we want to go to partition 3, and then we would do mod by 2 to the 16, and that would tell us the position is 50. So in this case here, we're storing this as a bitmap, so what we'll want to do is we'll want to set position 50, because that's what we're getting from this, to now be 1. So now anytime we want to do a lookup and say, you know, does this thing actually exist, we would know, we can do the lookup and see that. Again, this is just another way to represent bitmaps. All right, so the last thing I want to talk about is another secondary index called column imprints. And this is sort of builds on top of all the bitmap stuff we've been talking about today. Right, so this is not this is not something you do differently or in exchange of having a bitmap index. This is something you do in addition to having a bitmap index. So the basic idea of what you're going to do is you're going to store a bitmap for a cache line of values in a table, and you're going to store a bit in this bitmap that says whether there is a value that exists at a byte slice or position that's been set to 1. Right. So the idea is here, say we have original data keys 184, and this is our regular bitmap indexes that we had before. So these are all the different values, and we have a 1 whether at each row or offset that says whether the tuple has this value. So at position 1, we have a 1. For the second tuple, we have an 8. And then at the third tuple, we have a 4. So now what the column imprint does is now store an addition bitmap vector that says for this entire bitmap index, whether there's a 1 at each byte slice or bit slice. right? And the idea here is now you can now do a bunch of additional comparisons, like min and max, sort of like the zone map stuff that I talked about before, where all you need to do is look at this column imprint to decide whether you're going to find the match that you're looking for in your predicate in the original bitmap index. So it's a sort of way you're taking a sort of a compressed representation or approximation of what's in the bitmap index is now stored in this column imprint. Right? It's just sort of another way to have, you have multiple levels of these things. It's all transparent to the application because the database system can do this internally underneath the covers. So this is only actually implemented in MonadB. And there's a paper that came out two or three years ago that shows this gives you a big performance win for sort of DSS application or DSS queries. Okay, so sort of to finish up, the key thing that sort of he brought up is that in order for all these bitmaps to work, the position of a tuple in the bitmap index, no matter what encoding scheme you're using, has to correspond to the position in the actual heap table, the base table for, you know, in the database, right? So this is, it becomes tricky now when we're using like the append-only method in MVCC, because every single time you update a tuple, its position now changes, right? So this is sort of the reason why you don't want to have a bitmap index directly on the OLTP side of the database, because those things are changing all the time and the position might always change, which means you have to update all now your bitmap indexes. So typically what happens, again, you would have this bifurcation to say, here's the OLTP side, and maybe I'll use a B plus tree for that. Here's the OLAP side, and I'll use bitmap index for that. And as we also brought up two multiple times, is that it's really wasteful if the cardinality is really high, because then you're just going to have all these wasted space, right? And again, ephemeral means that they're changing all the time, and you have to update everything. We're also ignoring multi-dimensional indexes, which are also very common in OLAP queries. Right? These are things like R trees, KD trees, things like that. That's a whole another, you know, I think Christos teaches that in 826. That's a whole another ball of wax, so we don't want to get into now. All right, so any questions about OLAP indexes? Okay, so for next class, again, now we're going to again talk more about the difference between OLTP and OLAP inside of an HTAP system. So we're going to talk about different layout schemes for your actual data. And this will finally address the floating point issues that some of you were having for the first project. Then we'll talk about the different storage models of how you would store a row store and a column store. And then a hybrid approach allows you to do both of them together. And this is sort of going to be the delta store thing that we talked about earlier. Okay? Awesome, guys. I'll see you on Thursday.